And welcome to our community. Susie Thomas with you this morning. We're visiting with Dawn Campanelli. She is the president of Junior Achievement East Central Ohio. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having me today.
Dawn, you must have such a fun job getting to work with young people all around the area. Tell me a little bit about it.
I think that the most impactful part of this job is that we get to infuse business people when they're passionate about helping young people. So inside their classrooms, about 800 classrooms a year, reaching 17,000 students. So very, very much appreciated the opportunity to work with Junior Achievement the past 8 years.
Do you find yourself spending more time with the business people who are going into the classroom, or do you get to spend a little time in the classroom yourself, or how does that look?
So we spend a lot of time training volunteers. We have about an 80% sustainability from year to year. So very thankful for about 1,000 volunteers that not just do it once, but do it often and repeat it every year. That is great for our students. I also enjoy the opportunity, along with our colleagues from Junior Achievement and our great board members, to also be in the classroom so that we don't lose sight of the impact mission, to understand how important it is for us as business people to let students know how to connect to the real world.
Mm-hmm. What do you find their knowledge is when you come in? And first, I should say, what age groups are you working with?
So our board of directors have a kind of a primary goal. We're working with primarily with 8th through 12th graders.
Mm-hmm.
So those next consumers, next employees. If we're helping them dream big, they're going to be our next employers, creating jobs for our community. So I think that what we find is that they don't know what they don't know until we tell them.
Exactly.
So they are very eager to make those connections to better understand how to apply what they're learning in school to their future career, their future finances, and entrepreneurship thinking.
Thinking back to how I was at that age, and going to think back to the era that it was, anything that had anything to do with money or materialism or prosperity, I was completely opposed to, because, you know, that just wasn't cool. We were all going to be hippies at that time. And so in the 21st century, what seems to be a young person's view of just money?
There's a lot of confusion. As you mm-hmm. can imagine, now we're using economic tools that are electronic.
Exactly.
How we spend, how we right. save, how we invest right. all happens through that computer or
phone,
a swipe card.
Exactly.
So actually feeling, touching dollars in coins is not so much anymore.
That's pretty rare, isn't it?
Yeah. So it's really important that they understand how those tools work. Because unfortunately, if they don't and then they have their money, you know, that can cause a lot of downfalls in terms of personal finances.
Very interesting. And let's talk about these corporate volunteers a little bit.
Sure.
That 80% of them come back and do it again. So they must have a pretty good experience going into the classroom. What are you looking for? What's involved? How much training and how much time does it take? What does it take to be a volunteer?
So I think primarily what we find is it takes passion. You want young people to learn about budgeting or savings if you're interested in financial education, or you're in an HR position or work in a corporate setting where you are seeing the disconnect between students that want to work but don't have all the soft skills necessary to get and keep a job. Or you're an entrepreneur in the community and you really, really value how that is an opportunity for a future career, and you want to share that with other students so that they can practice. It's so important that we let kids practice these skill sets mm-hmm. In advance of having to actually be an employee or a consumer.
Right. And for that first job, what do you tell a young person? Because I'm amazed at how some of them show up for an interview as far as the clothing they've decided to wear. What do you tell a young person as far as preparing for that important interview?
So really, we really helped focus on what first impression means, how competitive this market for getting a job is. We put it in a perspective that's where they're at. So, for example, you know, a lot of students are already participating in sports and they understand that competitiveness, or they understand about how what they looked like as a third grade soccer player looks so much different as a high school soccer player,
mm-hmm.
and how much time and energy and practice they put into developing that skill. So we do the same thing on work readiness.
Smart.
You know, mock interviews, resume building, having other people give them that first attempt in learning, so that fail, we redefine what it looks like, so it becomes a business coach helping them to succeed.
I've always been so in favor of failing every once in a while because I know personally that's the only time I've ever learned anything, how to do something better, is when it didn't go right that first time. But how do we prepare young people to not fail to the point where they're so discouraged that they don't try again?
I think it goes back to that parallel of sports.
Yes.
You know, you have that coach. Mm-hmm. If they don't do the skill right, someone's there correcting them, but we're affording them so much time to practice again next day, next week, next year. But what we're doing to young people unintentionally is we're saying you need to be work ready, but we're not affording them time to practice what that looks like, to model what that looks like, to be the business coach, to get them leveled up to be successful. And so that's where our business volunteers use JA curriculum as a tool to help teach. How do you teach teamwork? How do you teach critical thinking? How do you teach communications?
Does it differ or vary from school to school whether young people have had this modeled for them at home? Do they appear to get a sense of, oh, yeah, I need to be thinking about what I want to do, what I like, what I'm good at, what I want to do for the rest of my life to earn a living? And go there every day and be on time and so forth. Are you seeing that they're ready for this or are they not ready for this?
I think that there's such a stress level with being a young person in school to do lots of things.
Right.
I think that as adults, if we can change our vernacular to be what are you good at? Tell me your skills so I can mm-hmm. help match you to a career and help you understand how you can get paid to write or how you can use that math and critical thinking. Or if you're really good at helping people, here's the careers you should think about. Unintentionally, our first question is usually, what are you going to be when you grow up?
Exactly.
That's
right.
Really hard.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And I know at the college level, they're going to change their majors five to seven times before they graduate. So even after you graduate from college and you have that first job, people change careers. But what we need, I think career can be kind of like an over-encompassing term, but purpose, right? We're talking about purpose. What's my purpose? And what's my purpose now? And what's my purpose today? And I'm hoping young people are seeing that they were born with a purpose. And what is that? And how can they use it?
I totally agree. I very much like the opportunity to tell everyone they have unsurpassable worth. It's so important that they see it, they believe it, and they know that what they have is different than what you have or their neighbor has or their parents have or their siblings have. When we can help them start to evaluate, you know, introspect for themselves, you know, why am I here? What is my skill set? How can I add value and impact?
Yes.
And then teach them to utilize that skill intentionally towards financial reward
mm-hmm.
and then help them understand their responsibility to balance that budget and include savings to set themselves up for a balanced success. The more we can match people with who they are and what their gifts are, we can help them have a balanced, happy life. And then it doesn't seem like a job or a career.
No.
It just becomes part of who you are and how you impact your community and your family.
Yeah, get plugged into the right job and you never work a day of your life is what we always told our boys. And I think, yeah, they kind of have done that. Savings, you said the S word. Do young people get that concept?
It's such a hard concept. It's such a hard concept because if you think about it, young people, as they gain resources for any first-time job, that's probably the biggest raise they'll ever get in their life,
mm-hmm.
you know, probably going from zeros or pittance, you know, to a $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, $60,000, $80,000 yes. a year job.
Right.
That's going to be the largest raise of life.
Big raise.
So we really, Junior Achievement's philosophy is that savings has to be part of budgeting, 10% or more, whatever you can do. If you're always doing 10% and you think of it in a percentage, you're always putting in that safety net
mm-hmm.
For the life emergencies adults know are going to happen, but young people think aren't aware of.
Spent a little time with my five-year-old granddaughter the other day, and she was talking about having a lemonade stand. And I just thought, okay, I'm going to start planting a little money seeds here. You know, and I said, okay. And then when you get paid, then you'll have money and you can take about 10% of that and give it to somebody who's poor, who doesn't have anything. And then take about 10% of that and save it for a rainy day. And then the rest of it you can spend. And she was right away, but grandma, I would want to spend all of it.
Yeah.
So, yes, that's the problem. That's why we have to learn how to use it.
And then so what Junior Achievement has done is we have great partners like the Burton D. Morgan Foundation that has Northeast Ohio Lemonade Day. So I'm going to make sure I get back to you this opportunity where you can turn that entrepreneurship idea of lemonade stand into a great lesson on innovation processes as well as the financial requirements that come with being a business owner.
My goodness, you've got it going on all over. Okay. And so you've just taken us from where we were speaking about work readiness, and entrepreneurship is another one of your key focus areas. Talk about what else you do with the young people to teach them how to take their ideas and turn it into a job.
Yeah, so there is an ecosystem within Northeast Ohio that affords such a great opportunity for us to invent. Mm-hmm. Create. But there's so many other processes that are involved. Understanding your target market, you know, creating a business plan. A lot of things happen with that production line of just being able to, you know, produce your product and sell it. So what we do is we intentionally at a high school level, we've started 11 companies again this year. So collectively, year after year, around 10. So as you can imagine, you know, Junior Achievement is in that entrepreneurship space from A to Z. It's their company, their idea. We just provide the tools and the resources. So again, back to that parallel of sports, you know, there's equipment on the field, there's a space to play, there's a coach. Junior Achievement is using entrepreneurship inside classrooms, bringing business coaches in, helping with partnerships at Huntington Bank to have real checking accounts.
Wow.
They have money, having all those assets, a leadership structure, president, vice president, sales, marketing, production, customer service. So in the context of a school year, they have experienced all the ups and downs. And that's what happens when you run a business. It's hard work, lots
that's
of perseverance. But in that perfect platform to play, experience, mm-hmm. and like you said, first attempt in learning so that they learn best by doing. And I think that's hard for adults. We have to step back and respect. Yes, we probably can see what's going to happen, but
let them happen.
Mm-hmm. And then be there to get them moving, you know, back.
It's a bit of a safety net too. There's a bit of a safety net in this. This is not life and death kind of stuff. They're trying these things out, and if they make a mistake, then learn from it and move forward, and without there being huge, terrible consequences.
Well, you can imagine that experiencing those now as a high school student really sets you in a trajectory to better understand how to persevere mm-hmm. and to move forward from a mistake rather than let it hinder you or set you back from trying other things or pursuing your opportunities in the future.
And it's fun at that age to be able to think, sky's the limit. What would I like to do? Can you tell us some of the cool ideas some of these students have come up with as far as entrepreneurs?
Oh, I think this year we're seeing a lot of social and ecosystem friendly type of products.
Nice.
So there's really that. Our hope and our goal is that we are really partnering. That would be one way business people can engage with Junior Achievement. They share with us what your problems are. What are you trying to solve? What is something that you would like high school students to spend one whole year, kind of coming up with a solution, testing it, giving you some feedback on customer response and so forth.
Like, wow.
And
I mean, that kind of market research can cost money. And here you would have the high school students coming alongside for free, right?
They would be working for free, but they would also be in that partnership of learning.
Yes.
To be able to help solve problems. There's such great value add when we can connect students to exactly what our community needs. So that's a good engagement.
Very, very cool. All right, we do need to take a short break, but we'll be back with Dawn Campanelli from Junior Achievement after these words. You're listening to Our Community.